All right. Be turning to James chapter 1, put a marker in Luke chapter 6, and also in 1 John chapter 2. Now, again, I can't teach about anything except healing right now, be honest with you, I just can't. Well, I could, but I don't think that's his mind, let me say it that way. And around here, the mandate, as you've known, now it's not that way everywhere. Some depends on where he sends us to teach. But here at the prayer center, our normal mandate, our normal modus operandi, is not to teach what we know, but we're supposed to teach what we hear. Well, that's exactly what's been going on with me. Like even this morning, I've got two lessons, and these are already going on when I woke up. So that's what I hear, okay? And you're going to see how it ties in with revival. I just tell you right now what he's doing. He's trying to kill y'all. And me included. I mean, you know. And the words he's using, he says, you're going to become truly my witness to this generation. But do you know what the Greek word for witness is? It's martyr. Yeah. Whether you die, you know, physically or not, I don't know. But every time you really witness for Jesus, you're laying down your pride. You're laying down what they think of you. You're laying down everything and just being his witness. And that's what he said. That's really why he gave you the Holy Ghost. He said, I don't want you to go and try and witness for me until you receive this power. But you shall receive power after the Holy Ghost comes upon you. Then you'll be my witness. All right? So he's getting us to martyr ourselves first. Is that a good way of saying it? Martyr ourselves so that we can be his witness with power. That was a good lesson. If we just took that right there and applied it to our lives, we'd be doing pretty good. Now, the title of this message, I know what it is. It's called Be a Doer of the Logos. And I'm saying it that way on purpose. Be a doer of the Logos. Okay? Yeah, most of you. Now, again, for some of you, this is going to seem so basic. It's like, my goodness, I could have slept another hour. But it's good to be put in remembrance of these things. Okay? And even if it is basic to you, you're going to use this knowledge to help others that it's not basic to. Again, these are more like, you'll see when I get into it here, these are more like classroom lessons right now. I encourage you to write down scriptures, make notes. If you don't have the ability to do that, listen or watch online where you can do that. It's going to help you in what's to come, and it's going to help you help others if you have this information resident on the inside of you. All right, so James chapter 1, we'll start there. It says, but be you doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. There's two basic Greek words used to make the English word. Be you doers of the word. One of them is logos. One of them is rhema. Okay? Now, I'm going to get more precisely into those definitions in a moment, but you just right now, let's say it this way. When it says, in the beginning was the word, the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Every time, that's the word logos. Jesus is the express image of God. If you want to know God, if you want to see the Father, who do you look at? You look at Jesus. He is the logos. He is the entire counsel of God. He is God made manifest where you can see him in the flesh. Amen? So here when it says, be you doers of the Logos, see, there is such a thing as a rhema. I'm going to jump ahead a little bit in the lesson. The easiest definition of rhema is Ephesians chapter 6, where it says, taking the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Now there, that's the word rhema. If you want to know an illustration of that, like in a warfare, remember, put on the whole armor, take the sword of the Spirit, which is the rhema, the word of God. If you want to see the application of that, how did Jesus do it when he was at war with the devil out in the wilderness? He took the logos, put it in his mouth. It is written, then he quoted the word, and that is the rhema. Now, that's primarily, scripturally, how a logos becomes a rhema. Whatever situation you're in, you draw from the reservoir of the logos within you, put that in your mouth, that becomes your weapon of war. And the enemy has no, he has no defense against it at all. You will win every time. Amen? Amen? But now today's lesson, we're not, now we have, today's not so much focusing on the rhema. Today we're going to focus, and there is a rhema, you'll see it again in a little bit, hopefully we'll get that far. There is also a present hour speaking of the Lord, a rhema word, a right now word, and it can come in various ways. Okay, I'm jumping too far ahead. James chapter 1, verse 22. Be you doers of the logos, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Now, James is not saying be a doer of this, just of, of course you're supposed to do what God tells you individually. Of course you are. Okay? Whatever he says to you, do it. But that's not really what James is talking about here. He's not talking about that individual rhema that you get from the Lord. He's talking about you need to be a doer of what Jesus said. You need to be a doer of what he said. When he says, love your enemies, he wasn't kidding. And it's not selective. And it's not optional. That last one didn't get as many amens, you see. All right, let's go over to Luke 6 now. Luke 6. Dave has taught us extensively out of Luke 6. Yeah, before I, in my BD, before Dave days, you know, there's BD and AD, before Dave, after Dave. In my BD days, I thought there was only one verse in Luke 6, because that's the only one the preachers on TV ever used. It'll be given unto you, etc., etc. But Dave comes along and tells us, no, every verse means what it means in the setting that God gave it. You have to read it in the context, and it means what it means in that context. It doesn't mean anything else, okay? So Dave, he would say, like Luke 6, 46, let's go there. Why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things which I say? Whoso cometh to me and heareth my sayings and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like. That word sayings is logos. Logos. He said, not rhema. Logos. Now see, this is, I'm going to divert a little. This is what's so dangerous, in my opinion, about a portion of the radical grace doctrine that a lot of friends of mine are already have somewhat drunk the Kool-Aid with the poison. Okay? Because I hear them, I can just hear little things saying, like, you know, about Jesus' words not applying to Christians today. Just various things, see. Jesus said this same thing in Luke 7. We could go over to, Matthew 7. We could go over to Matthew 7. He said the very same thing. Why do you call me Lord and don't do the things which I say? Logos. That's at the end of the Sermon on the Mount. And these radical grace people say, you don't even have to pay attention to the Sermon on the Mount. And he's going, not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, is going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. But those that do the will of my Father, and it goes right into, why do you call me Lord, Lord? And do not the things which I say. And he's talking about the logos, the things that he was just saying. And all that he said. Okay. One more. Go to 1 John chapter 2. What has happened, I'm not saying to everybody, but to many people, and I have to watch this myself. How many knows I believe in being led by the Spirit of God? I know you do too. Amen? But what happens is we'll get so, people become almost paralyzed waiting for a word from the Lord. I just can't do anything. Well, why can't you do anything? Well, I haven't heard from the Lord. He wrote you a letter. And you're waiting for a phone call. What do you mean you haven't heard from the Lord? You haven't heard, do unto others as he'd have you do, as you'd have you do unto you. You haven't heard from him to love your enemy, pray for them, do good. You haven't heard that? Buy a Bible. Read it. You'll hear him. What's happened, I believe we've become overbalanced. I believe in hearing from the Lord. You know that. I teach it, live it. But what's happened, and I don't think it's so much in, well, I'm guilty too. But some people are just like paralyzed. I can't do anything till I, quote, air quotes, if you can't see me, hear from the Lord. You're waiting on a rhema when he's giving you the Logos. If anything, a rhema is like the exception to the rule. See, for example, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Is that to everybody or not? Well, sure it is. You don't have to be an apostle to share your witness with your neighbor. Amen? Tell him about Jesus and what all he's done for you. You know, that's called being a witness, right? You don't need a rhema word. But right on the other hand, Paul and Silas, they were in that very process, go ye into all the world, and they were going to go to Bithynia. They were thinking about going to Bithynia. And then comes the exception. Then they got a leading, okay, not the timing. There is a timing of the Lord. Now, I don't want you to go to, and one of them was Asia. I don't want you to go to Asia right now. And through a vision, let's go to Macedonia. So they got direction, okay? Well, that's like course correction while you're in motion. You got that? You got that? You see that? But if you don't get a course correction, it's okay to go. They went to Asia later. At that time, he was talking about Ephesus. Spent, 2 years there, had a tremendous harvest. Also had a tremendous persecution. Okay, back to this. We're talking, so that what he's, this lesson today is, don't forget about being a doer of the Logos. We have a lot of leadership just from the lips of the master that we need to be more aggressive about doing. Okay? And not waiting for a rhema word when he's already given us a Logos word. Now, for example, 1 John chapter 2, the reason I'm going there. Nathan, are you here? Yeah. Nope, Nathan's not here today. That's right, he's on a mission trip. But Nathan's been teaching real strong about fornication. Amen? Teaching real strong. And he should be. It's good to hear a 30-year-old teach that strong. It's one thing for a 70-year-old to teach. It's another thing for a 30-year-old, you know. To be honest with you, most of my generation is not having a major problem with fornication at age 70. But. Now, some of them are, believe it or not, but some of them still are. But it's way more prevalent in the 30s, okay? Okay. Keep it clean, Gary. I lost my train of thought. No, I didn't. Okay. But Jesus plainly said, you're going to have to treat your body so harshly. The pain of telling your body no when it wants to do something really, really bad, like fornication. I could pick anything. He said the pain of that is going to be like you gouging out your eye, cutting off your hand. What's he talking there? He's talking mortification. Trust me, if you cut your hand off and throw it over in the corner, it's not going to cause you to tempt you to sin anymore. It has been mortified. That's all he's teaching. Jesus never cut his hand off. None of the apostles ever cut their hand off. That's not what he's trying to do. He's teaching us how harshly we have to deal with our body. Because the body's crazy. It'll kill you. It's nuts. It'll take you to hell if you let it. Now, he said that very thing. But see, in Nathan's generation, apparently, it's so prevalent, the grace has been so watered down to greasy type grace. Oh, yeah, you don't have to do that. His grace covers everything. That's not what Jesus said. That's not the Logos. Okay. And people, yet they'll come to church and sing songs and worship. Did you know the Pharisees did too? Yeah, they were probably right in front, you know, big voices, and during the whatever worship ceremony they had in the synagogue, the temple. And Jesus said, in vain they do worship me. In other words, I ain't listening to none of it. I ain't receiving none of it. Every minute they spend worshiping me is vain. And why? Because they substitute the traditions of men in the place of the Word of God. And that is exactly what's going on today. 1 John chapter 2, verses 3 and 6. Hereby we do know that we know him. See, those Pharisees thought they knew him. The fornicators today think they know him. They'll come and they just worship. They just sing, you know. Probably pray in tongues. Okay? What are you going to do with this? Oh, but do you need to quit fornicating? No, I don't need to quit fornicating. Hereby we do know that we know him. If we keep his commandments. He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments, is a liar. The truth is not in him. But whoso keepeth his word. Any of you want to take a guess whether that's Rhema or Logos? Well, based on today's lesson, you know. It's Logos. This is the same. John is basically repeating what Jesus said in Matthew 7 and Luke 6. Why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the Logos that I have said? Do not the words. Do not what I have said. Whoso keepeth his word, Logos, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also to walk even as he walked. Amen? He's our pattern. He's our prototype. And the flesh, this is all those lessons Alan's been teaching about the flesh and the boxes and the more. I look at those. I take some pictures. I snuck in a few pictures, you know. And I showed it to Sue and she went, poor Joe. Got all these boxes, you know. And then Harrison comes up with the cutters and cuts them off, you know. That flesh is never going to agree with you. It's never going to walk with you. It's never going to want the things of God. It's always going to want the world. It's always going to want it to have its own way. And it cannot be fixed. It has to be put to death. And daily, take up your cross daily. There's only one purpose for a cross. And that's flesh. I mean, that's death. Flesh, death, cross. Got it. Mortify. Okay. Now, I'm going to read a little of what I wrote this morning. Go ahead and be turning to Luke 6. We're going to look at some more here. See, I wrote this morning, I said, people get off in the ditch and become legalistic. They really do by teaching the word only. I've been in those churches. Have you been in those churches? Legalistic churches are so funny. Pretty soon you can't have a Coke. The church I first got married in, I thought I did good. I actually dressed up and put on a suit because I was pretty really young. Put on a suit, put on my favorite tie. I wasn't going in to get married. This was when I was first day I ever went to that church. Here I thought I spiffied up and I'm coming to church, right? The ushers met me at the door and wouldn't let me go in until I took my tie off. This is a true story. What? What's wrong with my tie? Well, first off, it's red. Yeah, that's gaudy and prideful and like the devil. Secondly, the second problem with it, it's pointing right straight to hell. I am not making this up. Now, do you think that was the Spirit of God? That's humanistic, logic, legalistic. That is not what we're talking about at all. Okay? I have met people off. When I say I've met them, I've met them. Get off in the ditch. Oh, I got to tell you the rest of the story. If you go to that church, I'm telling you, gum is sin. Cokes are sin. Everything is sin. Movies are sin. TV, on and on and on. I said, is there anything? Is there anything that we're allowed to do? He said, well, bowling's okay. Bowling? Bowling is okay. I'm thinking every bowling alley in those days, now we're talking a long time ago when dinosaurs roamed the earth, okay, I was young. But I had never been to a bowling alley that didn't sell beer. I mean, all bowling alleys sell beer, you know? And bowling is okay. Well, yeah, our pastor's a champion bowler. I'm not making this up. Legalistic, off in the ditch. Legalistic, okay, off in the ditch. We don't want that. We're not talking about that at all. But right on the other hand, people get off in the ditch on the other side. They can become so spirit-minded that they become flaky. They become irresponsible. And it's amazing how they always have a word for you, but the Lord never has a word for them. And, you know, they... And God, what was it? See, I remember that right now. I'm thinking of that story Dave told about the Elijah to come, you know, knocked on that lady's door. And she did have a prophet's room. She kept a prophet's room. She said, who are you? Knock, knock. Hello, who are you? Well, I'm Elijah to come. And the Lord told me I was supposed to come and stay in your room up there. I said, well, that's fine. You're going to have to bunk with the other Elijah to come that got here yesterday. Flaky. Off in the ditch on the right. We don't want that either. See, but see, that's what one of the many things I have admired about Pastor Dave. Pastor Dave always kept us right down the middle of the road. Great respect and esteem for the Word of God. He's the one that taught us how to meditate the Word of God, keep it in whole images, how to assimilate the books. And he was the very, see, if we back up in Luke 6, he would teach us, he said the Word and the Spirit agree. And for example, he would take those sayings like in Luke 6 that we looked at there, why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not the things that I say? And you know how Dave would do it? He'd go, well, the key is doing his sayings. If we could only find some of his sayings, we could do them and our house wouldn't fall. Where could we find some of his sayings? He says, maybe there's some close by. Am I doing it right? Okay. Let's just back up and see if we can find some of his sayings. And he'd go right up to verse 27 where it says, but I say, but I say unto you, he said, perhaps this is one of his sayings. Y'all can tell I've heard those umpteen times, right? I mean, I got them in me, those messages. But I say unto you, now see, this is Logos. This is Logos. I say unto you, which hear, if you're going to hear me, love your enemies. Stop right there. Let's don't go any farther. Does that sound like on Tuesdays you love them? Occasionally, it's optional whether you love them. See, at first you're just like me. I don't love them. I want them to die. My enemies, are you kidding? I told him one time about one couple. I'd pray for them. I don't want to pray for them. I don't want you to bless them either. I want them to die and I want to do the killing. And he told me, though, he says, you're not going to go very far with me unless you change that. You're going to have to learn to forgive them. I don't want to forgive them. Well, you're not going to go very far with me. Well, I want to go far with you. Well, you're going to have to forgive them. Well, I don't want to forgive them. Here we go, around and around and around. Now, I'm not going to teach that story. But I couldn't bypass the Logos. He wasn't going to let me bypass the Logos and just, I'm going to go on with you and become a preacher and teach your truth, but I'm going to hate those people. You think that's going to work? No, it's not going to work. If I wind up being a preacher under that circumstance, it'll be by my own doing and not his. Now, I hurt a lot of people along the way. But I say unto you which hear, love your enemies. Now, how about this one? Do good to them which hate you. So quiet in here. Bless them that curse you. You ever had someone curse you yet? Go with me to the prison sometime if you haven't. Boy, anyway, well, I haven't been to the prison in a long time, but boy, you can get your share. What are you supposed to do when they curse you? Now, I'm not going to curse in church. You blankety blank. Today, you're called haters, you know. If you believe the Bible, you bigot, you hater, you racist, you whatever, you know. What are you supposed to do? Pray for them. Love them. I guarantee you not many people are. Now, I'm not teaching on that passage today, but let's just read it, because that right at the end, we're going to really start getting into it here. We're doing okay. But I say unto you, again, this is Luke 6:27. I say unto you which hear, love your enemies. This is logos. This is to everybody. Do good to them which hate you. Bless them that curse you. Pray for them which despitefully use you. Unto him that smiteth thee on the one cheek, offer also the other. Him that taketh away thy cloak, forbid not to take thy coat also. Remember what Dave would say? That guy's stealing my car. We'll fill it up with gas first. Takes a love that, anyway. Give to every man that asketh of thee, and of him that would taketh away thy goods, ask them not again. You got to know God's your provider to live like that. See? Doesn't matter what they take. You can't take my, well, you can take my stuff, but you can't keep me from having stuff. God will replace all my stuff. Good measure, by the way, he'll replace it. If I really obey him like that, good measure pressed down, shaken together, and running over. Because you can't take my stuff. As soon as you do it, I give it to you. Anyway. Now this last verse, we're gonna camp on this one for a while. And as you would that men should do to you, do you also to them likewise. As you would that men should do to you, do you also to them likewise. Now let's bring this around to healing today. Let's take a moment and think about healing, because really I'm still teaching on healing. See, let's take that sentence right there a little farther. Whatever, as you would like for men to do to you, you do that to them. Amen? All right. What if you were sick unto death? What if you had an illness and you were sick and nigh unto death? And let's take it worse. Let's say you're homeless and you're dying. You got no insurance. You got no money. You're sitting on the side of the street with a tin cup or something. And you're sick and you're dying and you know you're dying. And you don't have long. What would you want a believer to do for you? What would you want if that was you? Would you like for them to just keep walking by you? Hoping that one of them would get a rhema word? That they could come and lay their hands on you so you could recover? Is that what you'd be hoping? You watch them walk by, busy with their daily lives. And even the rare ones that might notice you, they're usually either so fearful that nothing would happen if they prayed, or they've been taught to wait for a rhema word before they can do anything. Is that what you'd want? Or would you prefer that they just be doers of the Logos that they already have? And that's Mark 16. Believers shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. That is a logos. That is not a rhema. Now, it's not law either. You can go to hell. You can go to hell. Anybody can go to hell. You can go to heaven, I think, not do that. But I'm not looking just for fire insurance. You're not here at 8:30 because you're looking for fire insurance. See, I want to be the one that is a doer of the Logos. Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. I know there's apostles and there's prophets. We've all got a calling within that, but we have something we should be doing within that. Examine your life. What are you doing? I'm coming to church. Devils come to church. I've seen them. In people and out of people. They'll sing Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, and leave that service and go fornicate through somebody. Yeah, they come to church. See, I'd be wanting somebody who believes what Jesus said. If I was that guy, what would I want? I want somebody to come lay hands on me in the name of Jesus, and believe that Jesus meant what he said, said what he meant. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do it. We're getting there, people. We're getting there. But most of us would walk by waiting for a rhema word. See, you don't walk by. He's already written the letter. You don't need a phone call on that one. Now, even as I say that, I have to listen for him when he brings stuff up like this. I can't ignore it. Sue one time. See, you could take that other one. It says, give to every man that asks of you. Okay? All right? One time Sue was coming out of our favorite little Coney Island place. And I may have the details slightly off, but the essence of this is pure. This was like 20 years ago. But our little Carl's Coney Island, I'll give them a free commercial. They're on Southwest Boulevard, old Route 66. If you haven't been there, you missed half your life. Carl's Coney Island. But they're only open till 3 o'clock. You got to get there between 11 and 3. That's it. Okay? All right. Sue was walking out of there with... Now, when you go, you got to get the chili cheese coney with onions. Don't even bother going if you're not going to get the onions. Okay? Because that's not real anyway. Sue and I have been going there since the 8th grade. And they're still the best in town. You know? Anyway. I'm losing my train of thought thinking about it. Because I said Sue and Coney's in the same sentence. And it's two things I love. But anyway. Sue was walking out of there. I don't know how many. You know, she may have had 3 or 4 Coney's or something, you know. And the Lord said to her, if I got this story right. Because there was a beggar guy just sitting right outside there, leaned up against the wall. And she'll get on to me because I got my details wrong, but the essence of it was give him $10 or something like that. But she opened up her purse, and the first bill she come to was a 20. She said, Lord, I'll just give him 20. And he said to her, no, that would be going beyond my word. See, when you get a rhema word from the Lord, give him $10, that does not mean $20. It does not mean $5. It means if you have to go to the ATM, give him $10. You understand what I'm saying? The Lord is alive and well. Okay? Now, when he does give you a specific word, that's your word. Okay? But you know, it would have been fine with her if she'd have seen him there. Because she could have acted on the Logos, giving him a couple of bucks, $5, giving him a coney. Do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. We have that Logos, don't we? You can do that if you want to, okay? But if you do get a specific word, that's a rhema. That's a real word. That's something that you've got to obey, and you can't dance around that. That's like the, you know how you women are. You start planning your wedding from age one. By the time wedding day comes, you got it all planned out, you know? And this one lady, she, a typical bride, she had it all planned out. She hired a caterer. He was known for his cooking and did weddings all the time. And she says, I want you to serve lamb, and I want this, and I want that. Okay. But then when the wedding day came and the people went to eat, it was fish. It wasn't lamb. It was fish. Now, it was really good. Everybody raved about how good the meal was. So afterwards, he come to get paid, and he was asking her, you know, how did you like it, you know? And he said, well, I liked it fine. I mean, you did okay, but I just have one question. Why didn't you do what I asked you to do? See, on that day, when I stand before the Lord, I do not want to hear that question. I do not want to hear that question, but I'll tell you another question I don't want to hear. Why didn't you do what I told you to do in my word? See, it's both. It's not one or the other. It's both, people. We are doers of the word, and we are doers of the rhema. And at this church, by now, you should know both. You know his voice. Come on. All right. So the point of this lesson is we're to be led by the Spirit of God and the Logos, because the Logos and the Word agree. I mean, the Spirit and the Word agree. We are to take the sayings of Jesus in total, the Logos, and take that as our leadership unless you get a specific leading from the Holy Spirit. Now, let's get a few examples, okay? A few examples would be good here. Now, look at this. They're from the Word, Matthew 28, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, and so on, right? Go to Acts 16 real quick. We can do this. I know we can do this. I got to speed up a little bit. Acts 16, look at verse 6. Now, Paul and Silas were doing that very thing. They were on the road. They were preaching the gospel to every creature. But then all of a sudden, they got a specific leading. They were obeying the Logos. And this is normally what, you know, most people... God, I wasn't going to say this. I'm not looking at any... Most people... You know why they have so much... I just can't hear God, Brother Gary. Until you step out on the Logos, you're probably not going to get a whole lot of rhema. Mm-hmm. That's real good, isn't it? Yeah. You start with the Logos. You pray for your... A good thing to do. Where do I start? Well, how about praying for your enemies? Praying for those that hate you. Who was the last person to treat you bad? Go pray for them. That'd be a good... You could start right there. I don't want to. See, here we go. Get that sucker on the cross. That's the flesh not wanting to. Your spirit wants to. Acts 16, they were going about doing the Logos. They were going into all the world. But now notice, when it comes to Acts 16, 6... Now, when they had gone through, and forgive my pronunciation, when they had gone throughout Phrygia and the region of Galatia and were forbidden of the Holy Ghost to preach the word in Asia. What? Now, there's a rhema. See, that's what I'm talking about. You do the Logos, and you just do the Logos, but you'll get direction by rhema on that path. Timing and where and when and type of things like that, you know. They're just doing it. But then he says they were forbidden of the Holy Ghost. They were going to go to Asia, which really at that time, Ephesus was normally where they were probably going. I know the whole region was called Asia. But then after they were come to Mysia, they assayed. That's a miner's term, like you weigh in the scales. They were weighing in their mind whether to go to Bithynia. But the Spirit, and that's the Holy Spirit, suffered them not. Amen? See, that's course correction. Now, that's rhema while you're doing the Logos. But if you don't ever start doing the Logos, honey, you're not likely to get very many rhemas. Okay, let's keep going. So even though they had the mandate to go into all the world and preach the gospel, here's a case where there was a time and a season in the mind of Christ for their ministry. It was important that they follow the mind of Christ through the leading of the Holy Spirit and go to Macedonia at that time. Now later, without a specific quote word that we know about, not in the scriptures, Paul and Silas did go to Asia, Ephesus, and they had a tremendous time of harvest there. Amen? Okay? Let's look at another one. Go to Acts 10:38. See, and really, I could have gone to Luke 4. It would have been better where Jesus said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel and to proclaim liberty to the captives." We know that he meant healing in there, right? Because Acts 10:38 says how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power, who went about doing good and healing. Notice that word, all that were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. Well, that was his mandate. To go about and destroy the works of the devil. Anywhere that the devil had made the people sick, his job was to go and heal them. Amen? We don't have any problem with that. But did you notice this? Jesus, now I'm reading what I wrote this morning. Jesus was anointed to heal the sick. And we never find a single case where he did not heal the sick except once. And that was the case of Lazarus. When the report came to Jesus that his good friend Lazarus was sick near unto death, Jesus was led by the Holy Spirit to not immediately go and heal him. The reason? It was a trap set by the devil. The devil attacked Lazarus's body on purpose, thinking it would draw Jesus there to heal him. But the Spirit alerted Jesus that the Jews were lying in wait there to kill him. Even the disciples knew that. They said, "Oh, you're going to go? Well, we'll go with you and die with you." They've been wanting to kill you there. The Jews were lying in wait. They saw that Jesus' good friend Lazarus was sick unto death. Oh, he'll come. We'll wait right here. We'll arrest him when he gets here. But see, if you listen to the Holy Spirit, here comes that guidance in the process of the Logos. You see that? So, it was a trap set by the devil, expecting Jesus to come to Bethany to heal Lazarus, and by so doing, he would have been arrested by the Jews who were there wanting to kill him. Jesus followed the leading of the Spirit to wait until Lazarus died. See, once you really, your mind really becomes renewed and all things are possible, you lose a lot of fear. Oh, if I don't go, Lazarus will die. But the higher mind of Christ is, oh, my Father will just raise him from the dead. We got a ways to go in our mind renewal. So Jesus followed the leading of the Spirit to wait till Lazarus died. The Jews dispersed. They go, well, he's dead. I guess Jesus ain't coming. So they left. Then it was safe to go and just simply raise Lazarus from the dead, which, by the way, is no harder for God than healing your cold. Amen? So even Jesus, he did the Logos. He did what he was commissioned to do. But even him, we see him being led by the Spirit, course correction on his path. That's the way it's supposed to work. Okay. Now, we are to do the sayings of Jesus. Hang on a minute. By default. Okay, I read that. Okay. We are to do the sayings of Jesus, the Logos, by default. That is your default position. You got that? You don't need a rhema word to pray for your enemies. You already have it. Unless you get a specific leading from the Holy Spirit otherwise. Now I want to actually read this. I said it a while ago. I got ahead of myself. But I want this on the tape. I heard this one. I don't know when I first heard this, but it's a perfect illustration. See, the Logos really is what we have in your hand. This is the book. These are the words. This is the Logos. Jesus really is the Logos. The entire... He's God. He's God made manifest in the flesh where you can see him. But his words, he says, if you're going to call me Lord, you got to do my Logos. Amen? Do the Logos. All right? So we have the written word is what I'm saying. Now, so here's that actual story. The parents left town for a week of vacation. They left written instructions to their adult son who was living in the home with them at the time. He was going to stay. They were going on vacation. Those instructions told him what he needed to do during his parents' absence. It was things like mow the lawn, take out the trash on Wednesday, change the cat litter, so forth. The parents were gone for a few weeks. When they returned, the first thing they noticed was that the lawn was knee-high. They opened the door and saw the trash, every trash can in the house was overflowing, trash spilled out on the floor. And the house reeked of cat urine. Their son was taking a nap on the couch while the TV was still playing. They woke him up and asked him why he did not do what they had told him to do while they were gone. His response was, well, I thought if you really had something you wanted me to do, you would have called me on the telephone. We already wrote it down for you what to do. And we expected you to do what we wrote. So that analogy fits Jesus' command perfectly to do his sayings. He has given us written instructions what we are to do while he is in heaven. We don't need to wait until he calls us on the, quote, telephone. You know what I mean by that? Waiting for a rhema word. I believe in rhema words. Much of my life is based on rhema words, but that does not relieve me from doing the Logos. Okay? We don't need to wait until he calls us on the telephone to tell us what to do when he has already told us what to do in written form. We are to do his instructions by default unless we get a telephone call by way of the Holy Spirit revising those instructions at a certain time and place. Otherwise, we're just to be good stewards and be about our Lord's business. Now go to Matthew 24. Yay, I think we're going to get this all in. Yay. I always tell him, Lord, can't be done. He said, yet can. Matthew 24. Since my friends arrived a little bit, I want to say this sentence again. Where he's taken us is from being students to being witnesses. And the Greek word for witness is martyr. Got to remember that part. Okay? You lay your life down for the kingdom. Amen? I don't mean you're going to physically die, but your life, quote, dies. Your agenda dies. Your self-pride dies. Be his witness. Well, they might hate me. Be his witness. They might not like me anymore. Be his witness. Don't leave Jerusalem. Don't you go anywhere. Don't you even think about being my witness till you have received this power from on high. But when you have received the Holy Ghost, you will receive that power. Then you shall be my witness. Matthew 24, starting in verse 45. It says, who then is a faithful and wise servant whom his Lord hath made ruler over his household to give them meat in due season? Now that word meat is an old King James word. It just means food. It doesn't mean T-bone necessarily. Food, feed. Blessed is that servant whom his Lord, when he cometh, shall find so doing. Doing what? Feeding the people. In other words, whatever it is the Lord called you to do, when he comes back, he sees you doing that. Well, he's called us all to do the Logos. Okay, that's the lesson today. Love your neighbor. Love your enemies. Do good to them. Pray for them. Verily I say unto you, he shall make him ruler over all his goods. And if that evil servant say in his heart, my Lord delays his coming, begins to smite his fellow servants and to eat and drink with the drunken, the Lord of that servant shall come in a day when he looks not for him, and in an hour that he's not aware of, shall cut him asunder. And boy, now I don't ever want to be with the hypocrites, do you? Sometimes I feel like a big hypocrite, and when I do, I repent all I know how. But don't tell me you don't ever feel like a hypocrite either. It's one thing to have a hypocritical moment or day. It's another thing to be a hypocrite. Okay, repent, get back, do right. Anyway, shall appoint him his portion with the hypocrites. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I bet there is. Now go over to Matthew 25, one chapter over. He also that had received two talents. Before we leave, man, he gave his servant instructions. This one, it was to feed, it was to serve. What did the Lord want to find when he come back? Feeding and serving. Okay? Here's another one, Matthew 25. This is when the Lord left and he gave two talents to one servant and four talents to another servant, and then, you know the whole story. He also that had received two talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me two talents. Behold, I've gained two other talents beside them. In other words, he was being about the Lord's business. Whatever it was the Lord had him doing, he was doing it to cause notice, increase for the kingdom. Not for himself. Increase for the kingdom. His Lord said unto him, well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Now one more. Go to Mark now. Mark 13. And we're going to look at verse 34. Did you know that the Lord has given you authority for whatever it is he's called you to do? Yeah. Do you know that authority gives you the right to call in finances or whatever else you need to do what he's called you to do? Because look at right here. Look at Mark 13, verse 34. For the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey. Well, that means during the time before he comes back. who left his house, and notice, and gave authority to his servants. Hello, servants. Now, we're sons who serve. Ladies, you're just as much a son as I am. In the kingdom of God, there's neither male nor female. We appreciate your femaleness. We love your beauty and your female ways. But the truth of the matter is, in the kingdom, you're just as much a son as I am. There is no male nor female. Amen? Not in the kingdom. So when it says, who left his house and gave authority to his servants, you are a son who serves. A son who serves. Get that right. Now, you're not a slave. You're a son who has chosen. You're just, Jesus is the son who chose to serve. That's you. Heir of all. By the way, don't worry about getting fired. He's your daddy. You can't make any mistakes he can't fix. Quit being so timid and scared to do anything. Well, I might mess up. Duh. I know that's not very high sounding, but duh. We all mess up. Get over yourself. But you're not, your mistakes are not bigger than your father. Anyway. He gave authority. Boy, I want you to get that. He gave authority to his servants. And to every man his work. And commanded the porter to watch. Watch you therefore, for you know not when the master of the house comes, at evening or midnight, or at cock crowing or in the morning, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping. And this is, I've got this almost a fear in me right now. It's not the word sleeping exactly, it's waiting. We've got so many people that have been taught so much, even by Dave Roberson, that know this message, but they're maybe not asleep, but they're waiting for a rhema word. And the truth of the matter is, they've already got the Logos. They've already got it. I mean, you can't find your calling in the Logos. I would never know. I'm a teacher. I had to get that from the Holy Ghost. But I know there's teachers. But right on the other hand, being a teacher, does that relieve me from love thy neighbor? Pray for those that despitefully use you? No. See, that's a Logos for all of us. Anyway. And what I say to you, I say to, get that. What I say unto you, I say unto all. Okay? He gave you authority. Whatever he's called you to do, you have authority. If you need something, ask. You have not because you ask not. Okay. Go to Ephesians 6. We've got 5 minutes to get in 3 pages, I think, here. Hey, we're doing good. Ephesians 6, verse 17. Now, we don't have time. You know that this is a military segment. He's talking about putting on the whole armor of God. Why? Because you're going to take a nap? You take the armor off when you're going to take a nap, right? Put the armor on when you're going to war. Isn't that right? All right, now, so this is a warfare analogy. We're going to toss us in revival. We're going to take this city for God, I tell you. I've got my part to play. I'm going to war. Put on the whole armor of God. But eventually, and all of that is defensive. You know, all of the warfare of God, the helmet and the breastplate and all of that, you only got one offensive weapon here. And here it is, verse 17. Now, the helmet of salvation is defensive, but here it is. And really, there's two because the next verse is praying always. That's your other weapon. But taking the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Now, this time it is rhema. This is rhema. I'm going to read this again. Jesus is our example. When he was in warfare with Satan in the wilderness, he would take the Logos, put it in his mouth, and then quote it, saying, "It is written." Then he'd quote the word. That's how you do it. That's when the Logos becomes rhema for you. When sitting on your coffee table, that big old thick Bible that's got every marriage in it since great-great-great-great-grandma. It is the Logos of God, but it will never fight a battle for you until you take the Logos and put it in your mouth. We started in James. If we went right back to it, it says, if you don't learn to bridle your tongue with the word of God, and how, you know how you really bridle your tongue? You fill your heart with the word of God. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak. Got to feel, that's how you bridle it. See, when you're in the heat of battle, here comes the enemy. He's coming at you with a sword. You are about to die. Got the picture? You're in warfare. That is not the, here he comes. You see him, the enemy. He's dressed. He got his sword drawn. He's coming at you. That is not the time to say, wait a minute, devil. Don't attack me yet. Let me get into my Bible. I got to find me some verses that apply to this situation here. Just a minute. In the back, there's a thing that says healing. Just a minute here. Now, hold off. Just hold off right there a minute now. Healing. No. Health. No. Healing. Here it is, right? Just a minute. Isaiah. Is that the time?
No.
How about this? Okay, hold off just a minute. I need 3 days to fast and pray. In fact, I may need 21. That's a big sword. I might need 21 days. Yeah, now don't attack me. Come on now. Is that the way war works? You got to prepare for war before war. You got to have your strong military during peacetime. Anyway, that's another. Turn to Acts 5. Don't worry, Alan. I'm not going to run into you too long here. Alan has the next service. I hope I took every scripture his. I hope I got every one of them. That's our big challenge every week. Whoever has the 8:30 tries to get, we're trying to get, anyway, it's fun. Now, this one came up recently, and it's not the first. See, sometimes, let's talk about Rhema for a minute. I've mainly focused on the Logos here today, but let's talk about Rhema, because you do need the Rhema of God. God's not a cookie cutter God. I mean, you're an individual, you got a place, okay? Now, sometimes when I need a leading, and sometimes even when people ask me for my counsel, I had one recently, I'm not going to tell what it was about, but they, find Acts chapter 5 myself, I'm sorry. This lady, she had a question, and it's a good question. She didn't know whether the Lord had wanted her to do a certain thing, okay? It's an important thing. This is not a little thing. It's a life-changing thing. And she just wasn't sure, She said, well, I want to do it if the Lord wants me to do it, but can you see if you get a witness? And that's okay. Sometimes I'll pray and ask certain people that I trust, see if they can get a witness, I don't think that's God's best. I mean, God's best is pray until you know, okay? But this is one way. I just want to give you one way that a rhema comes. She asked me that question, and it was, well, should I do this or not do this? Is this the... And the verse that came to me, of all things, just, sometimes you'll... God could have chosen... I have a reservoir of scripture in me. You know that, right? He could have chosen any verse from Genesis to maps to help me, help that lady. But the one that came to me was Acts 5:3, of all things, Ananias and Sapphira. And he said, now, not the scary part. Now, the verse I'm after is verse 4, but let's start in verse 3. Peter said, Ananias, why hath Satan filled thine heart to lie to the Holy Ghost and keep back part of the price of the land? Now, here's the verse. And this is the verse that floated up in me to help that person. It said, while it remained, was it not thine own? And after it was sold, was it not in thine own power? Now, are you understanding what God's saying there? God was not requiring Ananias and Sapphira to sell the land at all. And even after they sold it, he wasn't requiring that they give all the money. They could have done whatever they wanted. As far as God was concerned, this was not a... Now, if God tells you to do it, that's different. But here, God wasn't telling them to do it. While it was your land, couldn't you have kept it if you wanted to? Even after you sold it? Couldn't you have done what you wanted to with the money? See, where they got in trouble was lying about it. They wanted to make a show. They wanted to keep the money but get the glory. You lied to the Holy Ghost. But see, for this lady, God could have chosen any scripture in his word and brought that to my mind immediately when that person asked the question, but he brought this one. Well, what does that tell you? Because it had to do with giving something. I said, well, the Lord is saying it's up to you. He's not requiring you to do it. You can do it if you want to. This is not one where, this is not, it's up to you. It's in your possession. And he's saying you can do what you want to with this one. Isn't that good?
Yes.
Now, see, he could have brought up a word, the Holy Spirit, he'll put you in remembrance, you know. He could have brought up a word that would have been opposite, but he didn't. Okay, so that's one way rhema comes. Oh, God, I'm over. Okay. So I'll just, these two will go quick. Sometimes they come by vision or by voice. And you can look that up in Acts 16 again and see how he, by vision and by voice, he led Paul and Silas to go to Macedonia instead of going to Bithynia or Ephesus. And then sometimes that rhema word, see, with me, most often I do hear or I see a vision, okay? But I really admire Nathan's testimony, and I know it's with others too. Sometimes that rhema comes like the growing of a tree on the inside of you. He said when he was doing all that praying down in South Texas, suddenly as he continued to do it, this knowing started to come, move to Tulsa. I don't want to move to Tulsa. But he kept praying, move to Tulsa. He said eventually, I remember how he said it, he said eventually it became so, he never heard a voice, but that knowing became so real, he said, it was sin for me to say. I did not know what he wanted. Isn't that strong?
Yes.
Now, I found a verse for that. Now, I'll finish with this. I promise, Alan. Acts 20. Hey, he's done it to me before. It's okay. Do y'all love it that there's really no competition in this church? I do, too. You know how rare that is? Anyway, Acts 20. Now, this one I have to read out of the Amplified for you to get it. The Amplified does exactly that. The Greek language is more expressive than the English language. This is more what they heard, okay? Anyone that would read Greek, which is the language used in the New Testament, this is what they would hear. Paul is talking about going to Jerusalem, see? He says, and now, I'm going to read out of the Amplified, and now you see, I am going to Jerusalem, bound by the Holy Spirit. Now, this is the part. Listen to, don't look at your Bible just a minute unless you have an Amplified. I want you to get these words to penetrate. And obligated and compelled by the convictions of my own spirit. The Holy Spirit had transferred the knowledge to Paul's human spirit. And his spirit was convicting him. Boy, if that doesn't perfectly describe what Nathan's talking about. And Dave talks about that. He says, remember, he says, if you keep praying, God's will grow in you like a tree. Remember? It's slow. And it may take a period of time, but eventually it will grow like a tree in you, and you will know that you know, and you don't know how you know, but you know. And there it is. I finally found it. By the conviction of my own spirit. Not knowing what will befall me there, he didn't have all the details, but he knew this. The Holy Spirit clearly and emphatically affirms to me in city after city that imprisonment and suffering await me. And right after that, he says, I don't count my life worth preserving. I'll gladly give it for the gospel. Amen.